who say yes to God by giving the gift of motivation. And in the ninth grade, I hope to continue success and become an honorable person. And I will always remember where I came from. M.S.A. The last time I was on the stage, you heard me recite those exact lines. I take you now, 2 years later, right in high school. I attend Archbishop Kelly High School as an astute student who favors two sports, track and field and football. My football team is doing great. We are 3-0. I love the fact that I play both sides of the ball. On offense, my position is wide receiver, and on defense, my position is free safety. Being the last man on the field helps me focus on reading plays and not letting anything get past me. But I am not just an athlete. I am a scholar. As a result, I contribute tremendously on and off the field. And to top off my astonishing high school journey, I get the rewarding feeling of coming back to Mother Seton, a place that helped nurture me to the young man I am today. Last week, I attended the MSA alumni event. Seeing Dr. McRae, Sister Peggy, Ms. Nickmeyer, and Sister Claire, and all the other teachers was amazing. Yes, a raffle was being held for the Ravens versus Steelers game. And I thought I wouldn't be selected, but it turns out I was picked. An anonymous donor sponsored 10 graduates, including myself, with those tickets. Our seats were right at the 50-yard line. It was seen on the Megatron. To be that close and feel the adrenaline rush had me in awe. The food I ate was mediocre ballpark food. I had a loaded hot dog, two cheeseburgers, a large fry, and one humongous soda. I know that seems a lot, but when you're really into the game, you don't know how much you actually consume. One play I remember very vividly is Antonio Brown catching the ball and just out-muscling Ravens defenders to win the game. The final score was 39-38. What an incredible, mind-blowing game. Yes, I'm very aware of the fact of how many children never get to see a game like that because of expense. I want to now introduce you to a man who understood this and wanted to do something about it. Let's meet him now. Hello everyone, my name is Blake Rockwell, and as myself told you, I love football. You see, I grew up playing sports around my neighborhood, but a heart disease stopped one of my older brothers, Chucky, from doing the same. He wasn't even allowed to run, so the kids, they made him referee every game to be a part of it. This meant so much to my brother, but you see, Chucky passed away at the age of 10, several months before I was even born. But my life was deeply shaped around a brother I never met. Later in life, I volunteered at the hospital where my brother had been treated. For 4 years, one evening a week, I visited young patients, and I discovered that we had something in common. Yes, our love for sports. These veteran children wanted to talk about and watch sports. They were probably bigger sports fans than a lot of kids, but few of them have never been to a game, and that was absolutely crazy to me. So I started a program called Special Spectators, which has given more than 10,000 seriously ill children a chance to attend a college football game. There are cheerleaders, a mascot, and a marching band, and families enjoy prime seats for the game. A moment like this helps to motivate these children to continue to fight their disease. So So I will continue to say yes to these children in honor of my brother, Chucky. Blake Rockwell, a man who motivates me and wanted to help the less fortunate. I will never go to a football game the same way. One day, I hope God will use my passion for sports as Mr. Rockwell did. And in the Bible, it states in Galatians chapter 3, verse 17, and whatever you do, whether in word or in deed, do it in the name of the Father, giving thanks to the Lord Jesus. So I will continue to say yes to whatever God leads me to, and I will be thankful. Thank you.
Sherry Franklin will say yes to God by giving the gift of care and respect. Sit. Sit.
I'm a good boy.
Hello, everyone. My name is Charles Rodell. I am from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, and recently graduated from Drexel University with a BA degree in animal psychology.
Yes, you can get up now. Go on. Go on.
Welcome to San Francisco. I arrived here 2 weeks ago from graduate school. I want to be able to earn a master's degree in animal psychology. My first test subject is my favorite new dog in the world, Dexter.
It's a surprise for you. Come here. Come here.
I am walking him along this cold, chilly landmark here in San Francisco. And yes, I am crossing the Golden Gate Bridge. Man, do I love this city! So far, I have visited Fisherman's Wharf, Pier 39, and Alcatraz, which is an island that used to be a prison off of the coast of San Francisco Bay. Even though San Francisco has all of these notable sightings, it still isn't easy being in a new city. I do not have any friends or family members here. So last week, I was walking down Alabama Street, and I saw a dog rescue center called Muckville. It's right there. I was feeling a little lonely, so I decided to go in and get a dog. I mean, studying animal psychology, so she would have a pet, right? After a few minutes, I saw a black and white American Pit Bull Terrier who was 8 years old, or 56 years in dog years. He was the cutest dog there. I loved him so much. Yes, that dude. Once I finally get my bearings, I am hoping to volunteer somewhere here in San Francisco. Do you know that feeling you get when you want to help someone? That you want to give back? That you want to make a difference? I want to have that feeling again. I used to volunteer at Streets of Animal Rescue back home in Philly. I know that God in His almighty grace will lead me to a new place to volunteer. Well, I gotta run back home to drop Dexter off and so that I can get to class. Talk there. We have just met Charles Rodell. Charles just moved to San Francisco to study animal psychology with his new dog, Dexter. He was thankful that Buckville gave him a dog that he loves. You have heard Charles share his desire to volunteer so that he can help others. Soon, he will find that place to volunteer, a place he was already familiar with. And soon, he would encounter a woman that would change his life forever. Her name is Sherry Franklin, the founder of Mobile, and she will say yes to God by giving the gift of care and respect to elderly dogs. Let's hear her life story. As a child, Sherry Franklin grew up with a huge heart for animals. She channeled that love into volunteer work at the San Francisco Society. She was walking dogs there 5 days a week. That is when she had noticed that some older dogs were not being adopted. These dogs would end up being euthanized. That is when a dog is put to death in a calm and peaceful way. The terrible truth is that dogs are euthanized every day just because they are old and not considered adoptable. These dogs have no chance compared to the puppies. This broke Sherry Franklin's heart. So in 2007, Ms. Franklin started Mobile out of the home. Her organization rescues senior dogs from shelters and finds them new homes. The group now has its own facility and has adopted more than 4,000 senior dogs. That is when Sherry Franklin started to recognize the challenges of her work. Senior dogs need lots of medical care. Luckily, Mobile has its own rescue. Every dog that comes through its doors gets defleed, dewormed, the full vaccines, and they get the full blood panels. Mobile does that all inside Sherry's house. This has saved them so much time and has gotten dogs ready for adoption quicker. Sadly, some terribly ill dogs are not very active. This means they are going to die very soon. Every once in a while, Melville gets a dog that has an untreatable disease. Melville stays committed to every single dog that comes through its door. They find a great home with great families, and they cover the cost of care until the dog passes away. When it's time to say goodbye, it's always hard, but you are able to share a part of your life with an animal that gave you unconditional love. Nothing will ever beat that. Sherry Franklin has a lot of compassion towards dogs. I can personally relate to Sherry's passion. When I was around 7, my mom had a boss who had 2 dogs, Emmett and Sophie. I loved these dogs and had a lot of fun playing with them. I sometimes even slept in the same bed as them. When I learned years ago that Emmett had died, I was shocked. I always knew that one day that would happen, but I never knew that I would find out about it during my brother's graduation party. I love that dog. I was terribly sad with him and did not want to eat anything. Rest in peace, Emily. Remember Charles, who we met earlier? Well, he just returned home after visiting Mama to get special shots. Let's go see what happened. Hello, everyone. So good to be home. This is Dexter, who we met earlier. And now, I have a second dog. His name is Ace. Earlier, when I entered Mobile, my eyes were open. I saw the mission and the work of Sherry Franklin. Could this have been what I've been looking for? A place to volunteer? To help out? Maybe I could volunteer there after I finish my studies for animal psychology. And maybe I could help the dogs if they have any emotional trauma. Anyway, again, this is Ace. He is 12 years old and terribly ill. He does not have one. But I want Dexter to be his friend during these last few weeks. I want this dog to die with care and hope. Saying yes to both of them is a true gift of love. Thank you. Christine will say yes to God by giving people in the world opportunities. Hello, my name is Jason Smith. I am here at No Limits headquarters, and my son, Dion, is trying out for the show. And yes, I am a nervous father. This year, the theater group is presenting The Wizard of Oz. I just love that movie. Do you remember when the tornado hit in Kansas? And Dorothy and her friend were walking down the yellow brick road. At last, Dorothy and her friend met the wizard. My son is trying out for the part of the Cowardly Lion. How ironic. There is nothing cowardly about my son. I remember the day he was born like yesterday. 7 years ago, so full of life, a gift from God. Who could have ever imagined the challenges that would lie ahead? I was nervously sitting moments ago and finished up on this poll as I thought about my son. I'd like to share this with you, if that's okay. One day, I saw a little child as lovely as a flower. He danced and ran. He jumped and turned. I watched him for an hour. This child of God was all the things I want my own to be. Magnificent of heart and curiosity. But when God made this little one, he didn't give him sound. He left him in a silent world where the quiet is profound. A deep abyss, a lonely world, away from all who hear. To never know the voice of man in happiness or fear. And as I watched his hands make pictures in the air, a silent, unknown rhythm that I could never share. For in this world of silence, the hearing rarely go because they lack the picture words, it never can be so. This causes me to wonder about the world of sound. What is it where we're missing, where the silence is profound? And then I knew the answer. It suddenly was there. To live and love together means people have to share. Well, that's all I have for right now. I hope you like it. And I'm really hoping my son gets the part of the Cowardly Lion. He has been waiting for this opportunity to be a part of such an amazing program. He has never been so excited for anything like this before. Well, I'm going to get something from the cafe. We'll know soon. Gotta keep praying. See ya. You just met a father who is sitting nervously as he is waiting for his son to come out of his audition. You heard the poem that he wrote about his son. But when God made this little one, he didn't give him sound. He left him in a silent world where the quiet is profound. Yes, Mr. Smith's son, Dion, was born deaf. Dion is trying out for the part of the Cowardly Lion in The Wizard of Oz at No Limits headquarters.
Yes,
he is deaf and is auditioning to be a part of a play. The theater group was founded by a woman who would change Dion's life. Let me tell you her story. When Michelle Christie
was a little girl. She was really shy. She spent a lot of time by herself and always felt a little isolated or unconnected to the world. For her, theater broke her out of that isolation. It always broke her out of her shyness. Playing someone else seemed a little easier. It really got her through those rough and challenging childhood years. Yes, this changed her life, and Michelle brought her love for theater to children she will one day teach, and those children have hearing loss. As that teacher, Christy had been helping them to learn to speak and listen. Theater, she realized, brought a noticeable improvement in their whole language skills and self-esteem. When you have on a costume and they're with all their friends who had a hearing loss, they felt like they belonged. She remembered just looking in the audience and seeing parents just weep. They're just so happy to see that their child can do this. The theater group was such a success that Michelle was asked to continue the program and replicate it in other cities. She founded the No Limits Theater Group. She traveled the country, bringing together groups of children with hearing loss to rehearse and perform plays written specifically for them. And Michelle had a deep sensitivity for the poor. She found out that low-income students were falling through the cracks because their families cannot afford the resources that their deaf children needed. She said it just seemed right to start an educational center to help families in poverty. Today, her No Limits organization has 3 educational centers located in Las Vegas and California, offering free support and enrichment programs to children with hearing loss. The organization works with about 600 children and families each year. No Limits has produced 100 plays in 13 states. The group has reached more than 200,000 people nationwide, and this is saying yes in a big way. Michelle Christie, a woman I admire because she has helped hundreds of families in need in a way I never could imagine myself doing in my lifetime. As some of you may know, this topic means a lot to me personally. A few months ago at Poetry Out Loud, I shared that I was deaf in my left ear. This topic is also so deeply personal because of my love for theater. Helping children like me that love what I love is so cool. Remember Jason Smith, a nervous father that you met moments ago? Well, good news, his son got the part of the Cowardly Lion. The show, The Wizard of Oz, just ended, and Jason is in the lobby waiting for his son to come out. Let's see how he liked his son's performance. Hello again. The show just ended, and I cannot wait to tell my son how well he did. For the first 5 years of his life, he did not speak. Last year, he received a cochlear implant, and now he is able to hear vibrations. But the moment when he sang the song, "If I Were King of the Forest," he had me in tears.
just to see my son sing for the first time of his life on this big day, my heart was filled with happiness. It has been a hard journey for Dion, and knowing that he is enjoying his gift of theater is so unbelievable. I am so thankful for Michelle Christie for saying yes and helping my son find his voice. She has changed Dion's and my life forever. Thank you.
We say yes to God by sharing his wisdom.
Step it up and be more active in their child's life. I appreciated what Obama said because most people don't talk about fatherhood. They talk about education and juvenile justice. But the missing component to a lot of children's lives is fatherhood. The statistics tell us that when a father is in their child's life, that child is less likely to be involved in very dangerous things or having early teen pregnancy. Having the president come to Chicago and give a speech about it pushed me forth in my mission. That is what inspired me to create the Dovetail Project. The Dovetail Project helps young fathers like myself be positive role models and responsible parents. We teach young fathers essential life skills, like financial literacy. We take the fathers to the bank and show them how to open up their own accounts. And when they complete the program, we help them get their job or gain their GED. Now it's one thing to help these young fathers by giving them the tools to success. The next step is to give them that opportunity to take what they've learned and actually use it. My goal when I started the project was to break the cycle. The young fathers in the system, they're seeking their identity because they do not know who they get that identity from. Some are coming out of the juvenile justice system and are looking for a second opportunity. And some are just lost and need some love and support. And at the Dovetail Project, we help them with that. They're looking for these resources in order to become better men. Sheldon Smith, a man who has said yes to God by teaching young men the proper path to becoming a father. I can personally relate to this. See, my father was not in and out of jail. He did not decide to be a part of my life. I've learned to cope with it though, as there are many other people who love and support me. Maybe one day I could join a program like the Dovetail Project. You remember Kevin? That's exactly what he did. He met Sheldon and joined the Dovetail Project. Let's see how he's doing now. Hello everyone. I'm out of jail and I met Sheldon Smith. I've had so much fun working with these young men. And my daughter, she's so, just holding her gives me so much joy. I always laugh when she giggles. I start my new job tomorrow. Working with Sheldon Smith taught me that there was more I could do to provide for my family. I know it will not be easy though. I would like to personally thank Sheldon Smith, because if it wasn't for him, I don't know where I would be right now. I'm out of jail, and I thank God that I'll never go back. Thank you.
Donis Salavar says yes to God for the gift of dignity. A poem entitled "The Simplest Things" by Lawrence Combs. It's the simplest things that makes life worthwhile. Sunlight on water, a baby smile, a Robin Wright song at the start of the day, the sweet little room, a freshly mown hay, a breeze in the treetops that whispers and sighs. Oh, bring starlight from dark winter skies. Crisp apple cider on an October morning. A morning dove's call, sad and forlorn. Rain gently falling on dry, thirsty land. A friend who will listen and then understand. A soft, tiny beach stretching mile after mile. It's the simplest things that makes life worthwhile. You just heard a poem reminding us about the simple things in life that we often take for granted. We don't recognize the simple things in life as important, but the simple things in life are what make our lives. Yes, there are so many
simple pleasures in life that we often take for granted. Like waking up in the morning to a sunny day, or bringing a smile to someone's face, or that hot towel right out the dryer, or sharing a good laugh with friends. Now you may remember, back at Christmas, I share with you that the simplest thing in life I enjoy is singing in the shower. I'm starting with the man in the mirror. I'm asking him to change his ways. No message to that man anywhere. If you want to make the world a better place to lift yourself and then make a change, yes, the simple gift of a shower is something that we all take for granted. I would now like you to meet a woman who understood this. A woman who inspired me. A woman who understands that a shower, not a luxury, but a simple necessity. And a woman who understood that a shower brings dignity and self-worth to a person. A woman who said yes to simple needs. Let me tell you her story. Her name is Doniz Sandoval, a woman who gained a new perspective on San Francisco's immense problem of homelessness. You see, it happened in her very own neighborhood. One day, Doniz witnessed three elderly gentlemen, all in their 80s, one by one, get evicted. They began to live in their cars, had their cars repossessed, ended up on the streets. Now you may ask, how could this happen? Well, as the Bay Area bounced back from economic recession, Doniz saw rents skyrocket. Diverse areas in and around San Francisco became trendy and expensive. Tech companies and other businesses moved in, while lower income families are forced out. She saw more and more people living and sleeping on the streets of San Francisco. And all of them were struggling with hygiene. When Doniz learned that there were fewer than 20 shower stalls and toilets for thousands of homeless individuals, she was shocked. For the homeless community, it was the equivalent of being in a third world country. Then, Doniz came across an article about the city's plan to replace old public buses. It gave her an amazing idea. Doniz obtained and began converting old public buses into mobile shower units. Her foundation, Lava Med, has since provided more than 20,000 showers for more than 4,000 homeless individuals. People would sometimes come out after showering, crying. Sometimes they were ecstatic. Sometimes they just wanted a hug. And it's incredibly humbling to see that level of gratitude for something that should just be a basic human right. I would now like you to meet one of the men who used one of the mobile shower units. His name is Vernon. Hello, my name is Vernon. I'm glad to be here with you guys today. I want an assistant manager at Starbucks. Life for me was comfortable. I lived in an apartment complex. My rent was about $500 per month. I was not a man of extreme wealth whatsoever, but enough for me to survive. That all changed when a tech company bought my apartment complex. Rent prices spiked. With my low pay, I was unable to continue paying my rent. I was evicted and forced to move out. No place to go. I began sleeping in the streets of San Francisco. I lost my job and began begging. It felt like my life had no purpose. It felt so filthy, so inhumane, so despicable. Then I discovered Lava Man, which means washing. I had my first shower in weeks. I stood tall and began to walk the streets of San Francisco with pride and thought that soon I will see better days. I thank you, Donice, for the simple gift of water and soap. Bernie, a man who found dignity from the simple gift of water and soap. A man reminded us about the simple things in life. But in life, we are given so many profound gifts as well, like family and friends. Yes, the people we cherish the most. In my life, the most profound gift is my mother. She is an astonishing person. She deals with so much, but yet is still so very strong. She has raised me to become the honorable young man that I am today. And I thank her for that. But lately, I've been taking my mother for granted. The pain I have caused my mother at times is unacceptable. And for that, mother, I'm truly sorry. And Mom, I promise, I will never again take you for granted.